So today what I would like to talk about is vapor pressure. Vapor pressure can be thought about as we look at this little batch of liquid of some material B. There's a certain number of molecules that have enough kinetic energy, i.e. temperature, that they can escape the liquid state and become gaseous. In other words, their pressure is higher than the atmospheric pressure holding them in solution. And we know this is true when you get around a material like gasoline or a fingernail polish remover, something that you can actually smell. This gives rise to evaporation depending on how these molecules are carried away if there's a breeze going over. If we were to look at vapor pressure graphically, it might look like this. On the y-axis, you basically have N molecules, or the moles of molecules, or number of molecules. And on the x-axis, you have the speed or the temperature. So if you looked at the current temperature, the average or the bulk of the molecules are basically traveling at this temperature. And that's why if you put a thermometer in that solution, you would get a temperature of whatever, say it's room temperature 20 C. But statistically, there's molecules that are moving a little bit slower. And there's also molecules that are moving a little bit faster. Now, if I was to put the boiling point of this material on this graph as well, you could see that statistically, some of those molecules are actually above the boiling point. And those molecules, that small fraction, they're actually able to leave the solution. And not every solution is going to have this kind of curve. Things that have a low vapor pressure basically are scooted to the left. The bulk of the molecules are not above the boiling point. Things with a high vapor pressure are scooted to the right. And the bulk of their molecules or a lot of their molecules are able to escape and become vapor at room temperature. So this is how you might look at this graphically. So here's another pictorial of the same situation. There's a small fraction of these molecules that are actually able to vaporize. And if you seal this container, this helps us to understand it a little bit. So now in the vapor, in the headspace above that solution, in this case, this represents a vaporous molecule sitting up there. Some of those will slow down and they'll actually start to get to a lower kinetic energy such that they go back into solution. So any material that you put in a closed container, at some point it'll come into equilibrium where the amount of molecules that are escaping and becoming vapor is in equilibrium with the moles of material that are in the vapor state becoming back to liquid. So the rate of evaporation equals the rate of condensing, the point that you establish equilibrium vapor pressure. And you measure this at some temperature. So you can imagine that the things that determine the vapor pressure are the intermolecular force. That's basically what is it that's holding these solution molecules together. And those are the intermolecular forces. So as the intermolecular forces are weak, things like weak van der Waals or nonpolar, stuff like hexane, gasoline, you know, things that you can relate to that are usually smell. If those are weak, then you have a high vapor pressure. On the other hand, if these intermolecular forces are strong, things that are polar or hydrogen bonding like water or glycerol, then basically it'll be hard to break out of that. It takes a lot more temperature in order to break it. So basically it's the intermolecular force, that's one of the factors. The other factor is actually temperature. So now if you raise the temperature, you can imagine that curve we were just looking at would start to slide to the right. You'd have more molecules with enough kinetic energy to break out of the solution state. In fact, the pressure, the external pressure that's acting back down on it also has an influence on this. So if the external pressure is equal to the vapor pressure, the substance is actually will start to boil. Now that doesn't affect the vapor pressure, the amount of external pressure. It just affects whether the substance boils or not. So let's look at boiling graphically. So go back to that original curve. Here's how things were set up. You had a current temperature where the bulk of the molecules could be found. Now you raise temperature, the curve is actually going to start to shift. And if you could shift that curve over to where actually the bulk of the molecules is at the boiling point, that's what the current temperature is, well, that's when boiling would ensue, and the bulk of the molecules would actually be going into the vapor state. And that's what boiling is, that liquid turning from the liquid state to the gaseous state. So how does evaporation work? you can imagine the same scenario where basically you have equilibrium vapor pressure set up. But what would happen if you remove the lid? Now all of a sudden those materials that are going up into solution, they might be carried away. And that's all evaporation is. So basically it's just solvent molecules evaporating up and then being whisked away. So let's think about the factors that affect evaporation. Depends on the breeze, the airflow, that seems important. The other things would be temperature, because as the temperature increases, the vapor pressure increases. Surface area, the bigger this container is, the more molecules that go up per unit time. Now, don't be confused that that doesn't change the vapor pressure by changing the surface area. It just means that you have the same vapor pressure, but you have more molecules that are able to go into vapor form. The other factor is actually depth of containers. The energy that these molecules on the surface actually interact with the energy of the molecules below. So the deeper this well is, it's almost like an energy sink that can affect the rate of evaporation. All right, so back to vapor pressure. Let's just look at these. Here's some curves for some different materials. And as we'd expect, the things with the low intermolecular force, they would have high vapor pressure at relatively low temperatures. And then as you start to build up, the things that have better bonding have lower vapor pressure. Okay. But another thing I would look at is just the shape of the curve. The way this grows with temperature is actually exponential. So what we've learned, if we want to make a connection between the temperature and the vapor pressure and things look exponential, you can graph it logarithmically. So here's I just isolated out water and graphed it logarithmically. You have to do a little bit of changing. Instead of just temperature directly graphed to the log of pressure, we actually do the 1 over temperature graph to the log of pressure, and you get a linear equation. And once again, the strength of doing this is that you're able now to apply y equals mx plus b. In this case, y, it's the log of p. So you could say the log of p equals some slope times 1 over t plus some constant. With this equation, in essence, what you can do is predict what the new pressure will be at a different temperature. And here's the data. And this helps us understand a little bit what the choice of constant is. When you plug in the constant, what I've done here is I basically picked a standard temperature and pressure. If I'm at a standard temperature of 0C or 273.15K, then C is adjusted such that that comes out to a pressure of 1 atmosphere. So this is the Clausius-Clapeyron equation, which we'll refer to as the CC equation due to my inexperience with French. But he was able to relate pressure and temperature to constants that we're familiar with, such as heat of vaporization. And so once again, that's the energy it takes to vaporize a material, which makes sense in light of what we're trying to get as vapor pressure. R is that constant, universal gas constant, 8.314 joules per mole Kelvin. Temperature, as we know, should be in Kelvin because this is related to the rate of molecular motion. And then C is it helps you make a logical connection between temperature and pressure that would make sense. You could do another derivative of this because the C can be a little tricky. We may not know the C, or let's just do a pressure differential. In other words, if we go back to this linear equation and we take 2 points, you can do a little math trick here. And basically what it does is it allows C to drop out. So if I the CC equation, if you subtract pressure 2 from pressure 1, you did that as the log, and then you took the other factors and subtracted for the T1 situation from the T2 situation, you end up with a nice, neat little equation. This is the common form of the CC equation that's used to calculate changes in vapor pressure with changes in temperature. Or you could use this equation, you could calculate the heat of vaporization. So this has 2 applications. And let's look at how this is derived from this equation above. First off, I'm subtracting 2 quantities from which I can factor out the heat of vaporization over R away from the 1 over T2 plus C minus 1 over T1 plus C. And then when I take plus C and minus C, is going to cancel out the constant, and that takes care of that. And that's why how I end up with this equation. And remembering back to your rules of logarithm, whenever you do log of P2 minus P1, you can also re-express it as P2 over P1. And reminder once again, this form of the equation uses R 8.314 joules per mole K, and it also is makes the best sense to put temperature in Kelvin degrees. All right, so let's do a couple problems. Here's one where we're basically trying to figure out what temperature would you have to raise it to get to a vapor pressure of 760 torr if you started at 115 torr. So basically we just set up the equation and we're gonna plug and chug. The only issues right now is that these temperatures are in Celsius. So we gotta make a little conversion. We know what our final pressure is. We know what our original pressure is. The final temperature is what we're trying to solve for. Here's the original temperature. Take note of how this equation's laid out. There's a couple things I'd point out. One is P2 is over P1. So P2 comes first if you're going top to bottom. In the same way, the corresponding T2, in other words, this T2 correlates with this P2, comes first in this equation. And the other thing I'd really watch out for is that this is a negative sign. That if you change that to positive, you'd have to flip T1 and T2 around. And the other factor is, look at the R units. Those are in joules. So consequently, what you put in for the heat of vaporization should also be in joules. So in this case, the heat of vaporization is in kilojoules, so we have to make that conversion. Times 1,000 will give you how many joules per mole. Plug and chug, solve for T2, you end up with 252K, and if you adjusted it back to Celsius, it's 79 degrees C. Okay, here's another problem. What if you basically did a measurement where you took temperature and vapor pressure in one conditions, then you changed the temperature and measured the new vapor pressure, which, by the way, you can measure vapor pressure by putting a pressure gauge in the headspace above a solution in a closed container. But anyway, you do this experiment and you try and figure out what is the heat of vaporization of water. So once again, R is 8.314 joules per mole K. Pretty much plug and chug. In this case, you don't have to make any conversions, special conversions for pressure. You can leave it in whatever units you want there. And if you need to, do a couple pressure conversion checks and you'll see that it still ends up being the same fraction. If I'd converted this, for example, to atmospheres, I'd still have the same fraction of 10. So anyway, I plug and chug, I solve for the heat of vaporization, comes out at 40,820 joules per mole, which when I adjust for significant figures is about 41 kilojoules per mole, which is very close to standard heat of vaporization for water. So I hope that this has helped you understand vapor pressure and how to use the CC equation, and also to understand evaporation.